Hey, everybody. Thank you for joining our podcast, Moms on the Move. I'm Jen Wills.
And I'm Jennifer Sesk.
New co-host. We have two special guests today, Brooke Archenhold and Stuart James.
Hi there.
So Brooke is one of our first sponsors of this podcast.
We're excited to have done that.
I know. Thank you so much.
I'm grateful.
So Brooke is an attorney with Parham Smith Archenhold.
That's right.
Personal injury law.
Yes.
And we met each other because I did the accounting for PSA.
Yeah.
I know. Right. And then I got into real estate.
Yeah.
And then now he is my preferred closing attorney at Black Acre Law.
That's me.
So two sponsors. So it's a big day for us. So we wanted to have a very fun and exciting topic to talk about right before the holiday season, which is wills and estates and titles. So obviously, this is not a super fun conversation, but I feel like the reality is that it needs to be said. Certain things need to be talked about and information needs to be provided on this topic, because if you don't know, then you might be stuck in a situation.
Well, and there's a lot of misinformation out there too.
Okay.
People don't understand, or they think they know what's going to happen if someone passes away.
And, mm-hmm.
and I can't tell you how many times I have someone come in my office and say, well, you know, if my husband passes away, then it just all goes to me, right? And that's not the case.
So in South Carolina, if you don't have a will, mm-hmm. technically it goes 50% to the spouse, 50% to the children.
To the children, right. Correct. So in a case like that, if you die intestate, which if someone dies intestate, that's just a fancy word for meaning without a will. If you die intestate, if we have a husband and a wife, and if the husband were to pass away, like our current situation you and I have,
mm-hmm.
then anything that is in the husband's name, half of what he has will go to his spouse, and the other half would be split amongst his remaining children. Okay, that doesn't sound like a big deal to some people, but it is when you have children that are 6 and 7 years old.
Mm-hmm.
And I always like to use the house as a great example of this. If you've got a husband and wife who own the house, the husband dies, the wife already had 50% of the house. So she's going to get half of the husband's 50%, which is 25%. Mm-hmm. I hope people can follow me here.
Mm-hmm.
So the wife now owns 75% of the house.
That's right.
But the two kids now own 25%, split two ways, is 12.5% each. Great. I've always said, I don't know about you guys, but my kids have not made any payments towards my house. And I do not believe that they're entitled to any of that equity,
right.
But law says otherwise. The other thing is, if my kids, which both my kids are minors, I have a 15-year-old and 11-year-old, they are not of the age in South Carolina where they can contract to sell a home. So you can't do anything with it. The only thing that you can do at that point is you have to have an attorney bring proceedings at the probate court to have someone appointed as conservator of the children. And even then, let's say we appoint the wife as conservator for her children, each child is going to get 12.5% of the sale of that house when it sells. And that money has to go to an account for them. And it has to be, it is
like a trust.
It is very strictly governed by the probate court. It's an account where it is a very, very limited risk account. And then the court gets final say so on what that money can be used for.
Wow.
So, and if you're, I know you're married, you think about, hey, if I had to sell my house because my mm-hmm. husband died, 25% of the equity, mm-hmm. you're not going to get.
Right. So this just happened mm-hmm. on a few months ago. We were supposed to close on a Monday with my buyer clients.
Mm-hmm.
Sunday evening, I got a call, like literally mm-hmm. hours before, and the husband passed away while moving.
Right.
No will. The wife was not on the title.
Oh my goodness.
So it's been chaos.
Right.
They have 9 kids.
Right. So in that case, wife would inherit, and he had no will.
He had no will.
And wife would inherit only 50% of the house, and the other 9 children, I'm not going to do that math, split that other 50%.
Right.
And anybody out there that has a calculator can do that. And some of the children are over the age of 18, and some are not. So now this house is stuck in limbo.
Yep.
Where we've got to get a conservator appointed for the minor children, and we've got to get the court approval to sell the house, which is actually going on right now. We're hoping to have a court order any day now. But that has thrown the whole thing into what made it even more difficult, because you're being gentle with the situation, I think. The buyers had nowhere to go.
Correct.
So
we sold their house.
They
already
had sold their house, and then they were stuck in limbo. Hey, what do we do?
Technically, we moved them into the house, which is not totally appropriate. They're technically squatting.
Right.
Which is what it's called.
Right.
So.
And because, and you and I went through this through numerous emails, we've got minor kids, and they can't technically sign to agree to have somebody rent mom and dad's house or their house. So it is just a total mess, but we are going to get through it. It's going to unfortunately cost probably a few thousand, $3,000+ to get all of this done. And the question I always get when something like this happens is, what could I have done to avoid this?
Mm-hmm.
And I would just say, just have a simple will.
Yep.
What you need.
And I think the whole time this was going on, I kept thinking, we knew his intention. He, the father, wanted to sell this house. I mean, he was so excited. My buyers were going to move in.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like this was nothing he would have ever wanted to do to his family on top of the stress of already losing him, which is why I think having a will, it's uncomfortable to talk about, but it's helpful for the people who survive this.
Absolutely. The people that are just, unfortunately, the people that survive are the ones that are dealt with the mess. Have to deal with the mess. I always say the person that passed away doesn't care, because they're hopefully off in a better place, and they're not worried about the mess they left behind.
Mm-hmm.
And that's when people come into my office, and that's when the tears start flowing.
Yep, because it's like a lack of realization of what this reality is without one document.
Right.
You could just mitigate that stress.
Right, right.
Well, and it's not a one and done, correct? You get a will, it's going to change as you change, and as your life changes, you have more children or the dynamics of your family.
And what I tell people, most of the time, when they come into a will, and there you can see they've got their wheels spinning when I'm asking them questions, and I always tell them, you have to draft your will based on things today. We can't foresee the future. Meaning, do you have 2 kids today? Well, we might have a third one. We don't know that. We have to go with the 2. Are you going to appoint your brother as your guardian of your children? Well, what we don't know. Brother may become an alcoholic or pass away 10 years from now, right? But today, if he's the right person, we appoint him. Now, what I usually say when there's a major change, like, oh, your brother passes away, he's the person that I'm appointing as guardian of my children, I need to read, you know, I always say every 3, 4, 5 years, pull your will out, read it. Is it still what you want? And if it is, put it back in and forget about it for another few years. But we have to look at the things as they are that day. We'll read the will and say, you know what, we've appointed my brother as guardian of the children, and he's passed away a year ago. We need to appoint a new guardian. And then you can update your will then. But what I tell a lot of people is, if everything remains the status quo, that will last you from, there's really, I say there's 2 types of wills, what I usually do. And I'll say, it's a simple will, and then there's a will when you have minor children. And hopefully, if there's no major changes, your will when you have minor children will eventually turn into, okay, now I just need a simple will. Mm-hmm. Because mm-hmm. my children are over the age of 18. I don't need a trust. I don't need a guardian. I don't need a trustee. And if I need to, I can explain who those people are. Then we just need, hey, if I pass away, I give everything to my spouse. And if we both pass away, it goes to the children. They're old enough to take care of themselves mm-hmm. and do what they want with the money.
I think a misconception is that people associate like the finances mm-hmm. only with wills. Mm-hmm. And unless you spell it out and say, you know, if me and my husband were to pass,
right.
where are the three kids going? I mean,
right.
Right. And that's one I think.
And financially, how are they going to? So that the money's tied into that too. So you can lay all that out. Not only who's going to, and this more Stuart's bailiwick than mine, but not only who's going to take care of him, but how is that going to be funded?
Mm-hmm.
And we deal with it from at Parham, Smith and Archenhold, Black Acres, our subsidiary. So we usually, client has these needs, send them to Stuart. But mm-hmm. we see it a lot in wrongful death cases. So it's not necessarily if you have assets at that time, per se, but we deal with clients that my mom passed away. We think she was a victim of medical malpractice. We have a lawsuit. There are then funds resulting from the lawsuit, and there's no will to distribute those funds.
Oh.
And so that's what we see a lot of times, where if a family were had a will, then we would have, been
easy.
Able to delineate that differently. So, I think people also don't understand you don't have to be a gazillionaire to need a will.
Right.
Yeah. I mean, everybody that has a family, that has real estate, that, has worked hard their whole lives, they need to be planning on some level. It gets more advanced as you have bigger resources and needs, which Stuart knows more about. But simple wills, like he said, simple mm-hmm. wills can be very invaluable.
And in South Carolina, anybody over the age of 18 can have a will. Okay, a minor can't have a will. I have my 15-year-old daughter who has nothing, who asked the other day if she needed to have a will. And I told her, no, everything you have is mine. If it's in my house, it's mine.
It's a good question.
It is.
She's smart.
She's prepared. She's probably trying to write me out is what she's trying to do. But so anybody over 18 can have a will. And statistics actually show that only about a little over 50% of Americans have wills.
Wow.
But I always tell people, I think it's about 54, 55% of Americans have wills. And I'll let you do this math. I can tell you what percentage are going to pass away.
Yeah.
It unfortunately is 100.
Mm-hmm.
So that means about 45% of the people out there are going to pass away with no will, which makes an absolute mess for their surviving
We did a worst case scenario with ours, where what if we all passed away at one time?
Oh my goodness, yeah.
And we just changed ours for that very reason. Where would our money go mm-hmm. and who would get what?
It's
dark, but that's we did.
Right.
Now there's
I tried.
One of the biggest misconceptions I have in my office when someone comes in to do a will, they say, well, I just don't want the state to get my money.
Yes.
Now, the state can get your money, but only if they are unable to locate any heirs. Okay, and that means
right.
cousins, uncles, aunts, mm-hmm. grandparents, whatever. And I have had people come in my office and they have no heirs. They have nobody.
Mm-hmm.
They are the last of the family. It's, strange but true. I've had it a number of times. So If they don't do a will, their money will go to the state. I don't know about you, but I feel like the state's already got plenty of my money, and
yeah.
everybody else I know is money, and that's not where I want to leave it. So what I tell people then is, if there are no surviving family members, to pick an organization or a couple organizations.
Charity.
Yeah. A lot of them will pick a church. Mm-hmm. Animal rescues, mm-hmm. stuff like that.
Foundations.
Yes, mm-hmm. and I say leave it to them. So a lot of times, they look for heirs. If they can't find heirs, there are no heirs. If your will states, hey, if there are no heirs, I give it to such as the First Baptist Church in Cherokee or whatever. That's where mm-hmm. the money would go.
Now, a little while ago, you made a joke about your daughter cutting you out. So we spoke about the importance of having a will for children. Now, what about power of attorney for the elderly?
Power of attorney is extremely important.
Mm-hmm.
I do those all the time. What I tell people, this is the this, and I'll tell you, I'll give, since I'm on camera and in microphone, and I'll pretend to you like you are someone that comes in my office. I'll say there's three things that you need if you're preparing for, you know, to be prepared for the end. Mm-hmm. Number one is the will, because we're, unfortunately, when we're born in this world, we're guaranteed death. So we have to, we will have to have the will at some point, no matter what. Now, the next thing is, I recommend a durable power of attorney. Mm-hmm. That is a document that just says, hey, in the event that I can't make decisions for myself, this person A can. Or, and then I always have a person A and a person B. If something's, you know, I appoint my spouse, if my spouse can't do it, then my oldest child. And that person can step in and make your decisions for you in the event that you cannot. Mm-hmm. Now, today, if a doctor came to me and said, hey, we may have to amputate your leg because of this accident you've been in, I can converse with him and make that decision. Yeah. Mm-hmm. But if I'm in an auto accident.
Your wife can't be like, no.
Right, right. And if I'm in an auto accident and I'm laid up in the hospital and I'm in a coma and they say, hey, we're going to have to amputate his leg or he could die, I can't make that decision. So somebody has to step in and make that decision. And it also has to do with it'll allow people to make financial decisions for them. Mm-hmm. I can't pay my bills when I'm laying in the mm-hmm. hospital. Or, as you alluded to, if I'm 95 years old, I had a grandmother who, I don't remember how old she was when she passed, but the last few years, she was unable to, she had handled all the family's finances, her and my grandfather, and she wasn't paying her bills, and some of the bills she was paying twice. Mm-hmm. She was just forgetting.
Right.
And my mom would go over there to take care of her, and she'd get a call, hey, we're getting ready to turn your water off tomorrow. Mm-hmm. Well, what? Grandmother's got plenty of money.
Right.
What's going on? Which they haven't made a payment. And then you go, look, she's made two electric bill payments, but she didn't make the water bill payment. I think people start getting confused. If we all live long enough, we'll have that issue. So a power of attorney would allow my mom to come in and say, okay, Grandma, you can't, or her mom, you can't handle these things anymore. I'm going to have to do it for you.
Right. Mm-hmm.
She can go and do anything that my grandmother could do. She can go to the bank and withdraw cash. She can go to the bank and move money from an account to another account. And so that's a very, very dangerous document. So you really have to
trust.
Be careful who you appoint. Yeah. Now, the law states that the person that you appoint is supposed to make decisions on your behalf and what's best for you. Meaning what was best for my grandmother was not my mom going and taking $10,000 out and putting it in her own pocket. Mm-hmm. What might be best is my mom moving money from account A to account B because it was had more interest, right? Mm-hmm. And it has to be, you're supposed to act conservative as well. But so that person you appoint has a lot of power, but they also can be held liable for doing people wrong.
Yeah.
So that's document two that I say you need. And then the third document that you need is what's called a living will. And a living will is the document that says, hey, if I personally get in a condition that there's nothing the doctors can do, please either A, keep me hooked mm-hmm. up to the machines, or B, let me go. There, I always tell people, with a will, we're guaranteed, unfortunately, I said before, we're guaranteed death. But if we go out in the street, in the highway, and stand there and get hit by a bus and we die instantly, the only one of those documents we needed was the will. Mm-hmm. But if we go outside and we get hit by a bus and we are unconscious and hurt and injured and severely brain damaged or whatever, we needed all of them.
Mm-hmm.
And we don't know how we're going to go, so we have to be prepared for both of those ways, meaning we don't know if we die instantly or we linger on for a long, long, long time. So we need all three of those documents to be prepared.
Yeah.
And the living will, just to go back to that for just a second, that's the document that everybody starts thinking about with the Terry Schiavo case many years ago. It was actually when I was in law school, so gosh, about 20 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
She did not have she was injured in some kind of accident, I believe, and her parents wanted to keep her hooked up to the machines, keep her living, and husband wanted to pull the plug. Okay. And you and I could take either side and can argue that all day long. Had she had a living will, that's what the courts would have gone with. Instead, okay. The courts were brought into this fight of parents versus spouse. Wow. And you and I can argue, like I said, we can argue all day on which side is correct.
Yeah, avoid all that emotion.
That's right.
Yes.
Yeah. So I was going to say, I think we collectively have younger children. Mm-hmm. So you think as a mom, you think about what am I going to do to help my children have less stress in life? Because there are things that are unavoidable. As Stuart says, it's a guarantee that we're all going to pass at some point. So planning helps really reduce that and mitigate that stress for them, and the challenges that a family may have. Family dynamics may change, and they get, you know, heightened emotions get heightened when we have to deal with stress and sorrow and grief. So it's better just to have it all laid out, because you don't know. I mean, I think that was a great analogy. You don't know if you're going to walk out and the bus is going to get you and that's it, or you're going to have a process to deal with. And with all the pandemic stuff that we've been dealing with for 2 years, I mean, there's so many unknowns. And if you have those vehicles in place, even if you're not hands-on with your loved one, you know, you can still communicate for them and help advocate for them, which is sort of what I deal with on a daily basis, is having folks advocate for others.
Yeah. In my personal opinion, I think you guys will probably agree with me, I would much rather, you know, if you put yourself... what you'd much rather want to know your husband's wishes, have those in writing, then you have to make that ultimate decision.
Especially if, kind of what you just said, his parents don't agree with, you know, if we had this conversation, but they're not privy to that conversation. Yeah. So I'm sitting here saying, no, this is what he wanted. And they're saying, no, that's, I mean, that gets so tricky.
I always tell people, when they're in my office, I said, you know, and a lot of times people come in and this is their second marriage. Mm-hmm. And I said, what are you going to do when your spouse, who is not the mother of your children, says, pull the plug, and the children say, no, keep dad alive.
Right.
And then they blame, hey, you killed our father. You know, and that stuff happens. So the answer is that the father to have in writing, hey, if I get in this condition, yes, you please pull the plug, or no, keep me here as long as the machines will possibly keep me alive. Yeah. Most people don't pick that option, but they're entitled to do so.
Mm-hmm.
And that takes out all the potential unrest amongst the family. This was dad's wishes, and that's what the doctors are going to do. Now, with that being said, there's always caveats. I've taught a lot of this stuff, as you probably can tell, and it's my soapbox kind of thing. I get lots of wild questions about it. They'll say, well, will they, just because if you go in and you're in terrible condition, they say, oh, there's nothing we can do, and they have a living will, are they just going to pull a plug right then and there and say, see ya? And the answer is no. Doctors are going to give you time, give the family time to come and say goodbyes and that kind of stuff. It's not just going to be, you know.
Well, he wanted this.
Right.
And then there are protocols in place.
The other question, one of my favorite questions I had too, was a little lady in a seminar I was doing. And she said, "Well, I've heard you don't want to do a living will." And I said, "Well, why is that?" She says, "Well, because they'll go ahead and pull the plug because they want all your organs."
Oh.
And I said, yes, you can consent to organ donation, and
which is great, by the way.
It is, and I recommend
saved
it.
My sister-in-law's life.
But they're not going to just, as soon as you come in, like, oh, we got some potential organs here. Let's take them. Let's get this guy gone. I've heard a lot of things. That was one of my favorites.
Well, I feel like this was such a good conversation, even though it was a little depressing. Merry Christmas, everyone.
It's never fun, but it's unfortunately
realistic.
No, it is
necessary, though.
It's important.
It is. Mm-hmm. So give your spouse the gift of a will for Christmas.
Right. Are your children? Oh, spouse, children. Oh,
no, man. Really, though. I mean, it is. It's a good conversation that needs to, you know, be had. And we're grateful you guys came.
Well, thank you for having me.
This is the famous Brooke who has sponsored us from the beginning. So thanks again.
I wish I were famous, but no, we've been happy to have the opportunity to sponsor you guys and happy it's going so well.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you both for coming.
Well, I hope we learned people something, as they say.
Yes.
People say, I'm going to learn you something. But it is a little bit confusing, and I think it is something that kind of freaks people out a little bit.
Yeah.
They don't want to talk about it.
Well, yeah, it's uncomfortable.
And I've always said, I think a lot of people think that they're going to get this diagnosis that, hey, you've got 6 months to live. You need to start get your stuff in order now. And that does happen sometimes. But you and I are dealing with the opposite of that,
right.
Which mm-hmm. is, hey, I'm moving tomorrow. And they drop dead.
Just
so
you never know.
Right. Mm-hmm. So you got to be prepared for option B. Yes, maybe you will luck out and get option A, where they tell you you've got X amount of time to live, but we don't know how we're going to go.
And the other
way will really mess things up because you don't have any time to go get this stuff together. So you got to do it now while you're healthy and able to think for yourself.
Exactly.
Mm-hmm.
Well, thank you again.
Thanks, guys.
I wanted to thank our other sponsors real quick. Obviously, we have Parmsmith, Arch & Hold, Black Acre, Nest Realty, which is my brokerage. Thank you to Corinne for sponsoring us. I want to thank Body Works. They are amazing, do all sorts of female therapy and Pilates. They're awesome. And then we want to thank Southern Girl Chic for dressing us. and also Penny Posies for our pretty flowers. So thank you. And to our title sponsor, Amanda McCall with Prime Lending. So thanks, everybody. And we look forward to seeing you next time.